Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined on this episode with the leader, the householder, the I don't know how else to put it, but you're the head of the House of Lovelust. It's London Lovelust. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Billy.
So I'm very excited for this one because I'm slowly picking up all the folks from Renegade Wrestling, just like one interview at a time. And finally got yourself on. So very excited to finally hear the story of Lovelust. And I'm saying your surname several times because in previous results, first couple of results we did for Renegade, I was determined your name was London Lovelust. So I'm just saying it out loud so I remember as we go along here. First question is always the same, though. It's a cliched podcast wrestling question. How did you get into pro wrestling? So what was the moment watching that got you hooked into it?
Oh, that is a good question. So I don't remember too vividly because I was about 7 when I started watching wrestling. But from what I do remember, it was kind of just a, you know, I'd come home from school and my dad would get home from work and he'd put like, I don't even know what channel it was on, like, but he'd put the telly on and he'd watch WWE, and I just vaguely remember this like sudden obsession growing while he'd watch it with like, he'd be like, oh, I'm into Sheamus and like, oh, Kofi Kingston and like, and I obviously appreciate a lot of the male superstars on the roster, but I just remember this ever-growing like interest in the women on the roster and like kind of being like, oh, it was even back then that I remember kind of like Beth Phoenix and Mickey James.
Oh, so I'm guessing from the names you've given me, so we're talking about 2009, 2010, kind of, or is it a bit later than
yeah.
that?
Yeah, I did start watching around 2007, but I don't remember that as well because... Yeah, I was only 7, but also do bear with me because I am a millennial. a lot of wrestling references get lost on me. I'll often be at the dojo and someone will say something like, oh, I remember this and this, and I'll be like, no. Yeah. And they'll be like, how dare you?
That's absolutely fine. All the things I always bring up is like, I've had quite a lot of trainees or people that have only had maybe a couple matches, and they do like their point of references. Oh, I remember Jeff Hardy, and I get all excited, and then they say versus CM Punk, and then I just like age myself terribly because I remember when he started, and that is definitely not when he started in 2009 time when we're referencing CM Punk as well. So it's fine. I will probably I'll try not to bring up too many pre 2000 references.
I mean, please, but I might just not get them.
It's okay. It has to be better than the last few episodes where I went into far too much chat about King of the Ring 2000, which I can't discuss it anymore because I don't think anyone else is going to appreciate that than I will, even though I saw a video of it today on TikTok, which is a whole other issue. So who do you remember? So you remember Sheamus, you remember Kofi, you remember the women there. So you said Mickey James, 2010, so you said Phoenix. Eve, Torres, Ellis, maybe.
I always said that, like, I'm not too clued in on a lot of wrestling, but, well, I mean, compared to a lot of trainees, but if I was to go on Mastermind, my subject would be the women of WWE from, like, around that time zone. Like, yeah.
I'm a big nerd for doing things like online quizzes during the day when I'm supposed to be working, and that always seems to be my sticking point. And I don't know why 2009 to 2013, it just seems to be just absolutely blanked out my memory of wrestling, and it's ridiculous, especially the Divas division. There's so many names that came in and cropped in and out and in and out, and I mean, last names I remember that are obscure were like 2003, and I was like Joy Giovanni and all those kind of, see, gone, not nothing. it was just a time where once the bell is, it'd be Victoria popped up at some point, it was a weird time because when you looked at the roster back then, now I went back and looked at it, there were so many great women's wrestlers, but it was still like the Divas division at the same time. It was a very weird mix that they never really got a handle on, or they're quite happy just to stick on one lane and it just be Divas. So the women were your jam for that when you started watching. Did you ever get to, because you're kind of central based, or did you ever get to any live shows in WWE?
I've actually never, I've never got a chance to. I'd love to, but I mean, I'm not even sure many people, like many shows came past near Blackpool where I grew up. So,
all right, okay. So you're William Regal country. That's where you grew up then. Right, okay. I don't know much about the English wrestling scene. I'll be perfectly honest. So fine. So between the two of us, we're okay. Neither of us know anything about down there, so it's fine. I think Preston City Wrestling runs down there. That's about all I've got when it comes to Blackpool. So you go from that, and then you're watching it. How did you go from watching to giving it a go then? Was there any aspirations to try it growing up? Did you do any trampoline wrestling? Did you do any backyarding? What was your kind of growth into that area?
I mean, yeah. Not trampoline wrestling, but like outside in the garden, which is unsafe. Or like on the bed. I kind of like started watching wrestling, like I said, when I was 7, 8, 9-ish. And then I kind of went through a phase where I didn't watch it for a bit, from the ages of like 11 to 14. And then when I was about 15, I started getting back into it. And then I kind of, me and my pal Chloe back down in Blackpool would wrestle a lot, but I got her into wrestling because she'd never watched it until she was 15 when I got her into it. And I don't know. I just have always watched Raw and SmackDown every week, and now I get to watch the pay-per-views. Now I have money to actually rent WWE Network. Also have seen little bits of like AEW Impact here and there, but again, not massively clued up in it. And then when I started living alone, when I moved to Glasgow for uni, I was going to get into it, and I went to one training session, but I cannot for the life of me remember where it was for some reason. But I went to one, wasn't a massive fan. It was quite brawly and rough men, and I was like a bit intimidated. And then COVID happened, so didn't do anything. And then after COVID had happened, I was just like looking up places to see how maybe I should actually like reinvest in it and get into it again. And then I found Renegade, and I messaged Michelle or Aisha, and she was just super friendly and like, yeah, please come along and try out. And yeah.
So I've heard your background. Well, I've heard a little bit of your background when I was speaking to Brody Adler for the first Renegade show, which, well, that was a crazy time anyway, because of everything that was going on around Renegade. And she was like, was blowing your praises, whatever the phrase is. I've absolutely messed that one up, but saying nice stuff about you. We'll go with that. And she was saying like you had like a gymnastic background, am I right thinking that? There's a bit of what was your kind of sport background? Did you do things like gymnastics, or what was your kind of background there?
Well, I've done dance classes, and but not like excessively. I'm trained in music and acting. So the performance side, I've always been interested in wrestling, the sort of actory stuff. And I've always practiced gymnastics like on my own growing up. And even before wrestling, I was like my dad would watch the Olympics and I'd be obsessed with like the figure skating and the gymnastics. So it's kind of more that region that I was interested in before wrestling that kind of made me practice gymnastics solely. But and then in dance classes I would always be like focus on the quite flexible or like flamboyant sort of moves over the like hip-hop or something. And then watching the Divas division, like when I mentioned during that era, really appealed to my interests, because there was like, yeah, like Mickie James doing Hurricane Rana's out of the corner, and like Gail Kim flipping all over the place and stuff like. So I kind of got a background in dance and gymnastics, but less so than I would like to say.
Right.
I suppose my body takes more naturally to just like those sorts of things, and I'm just naturally interested in them. Yeah,
I suppose another name popped in my head was like Alicia Fox as well, very flexible, and did all these like big scissor kicks and
totally
and the best Northern Lights suplex in wrestling. Oh. So I've heard. So before that, so you said just before that you did one session, can't remember where it was. Don't know where it was. I'm assuming there's mats involved, if it's anywhere that I could think of around about that area. And that was it. It was a bit too, I don't know, laddie, rough and tumble, blokey, blokes, lads, you know, kind of thing.
Yeah.
And then that was it until, of course, then COVID started. Did you go to, with that being said though, did you go to shows in Glasgow, like your ICW or anything like that? Was anything at all? Or was it just, you just went, I'm going to try this wrestling thing, typed it into Google, and there you went?
Yeah, the second reel. I've actually never been to a wrestling show.
They haven't competed on.
Exactly. I've always been the wrestler and not. Have I ever been to a wrestling show? I don't think I have. No. I've watched it on TV, and that's about it.
I mean, at least you've watched it. That's always a good sign. So none at all, and you just went straight into that. So COVID happened, you contacted Renegade or wherever it was beforehand, and were into Renegade. How did you find that kind of first couple sessions then? Because from what I'm hearing from the likes of Aisha and Brody, and I spoke to the Struthers and Katsabella and what have you, it's quite a relaxed environment. Did you find that was quite important to have, because you had this prior experience of this kind of low-key culture beforehand?
Totally. I mean, it wasn't even necessarily like, it wasn't even necessarily the blokey cult. No, it was, but it wasn't, you know. It was nice to have Renegade's atmosphere of like just very welcoming, and it is quite relaxed, but we do train like quite vigorously at points, I would say. But when I first went, I just did some private sessions with Aisha, and I mean, she wasn't afraid to throw me around. and it did feel like she threw me in at the deep end, which is what I wanted, because even though I didn't want to be surrounded by like this sort of blokey, intimidating, sometimes toxic, like masculine culture, I still wanted to wrestle like quite hardcore, you know, and well, probably not hardcore as a lot of people would call it, but I still wanted to like really throw myself into it, and I wasn't afraid to get hurt, and like wasn't afraid to do like bigger moves for a newbie. So yeah, but regarding the people involved and the fellow trainees and wrestlers, like it was really, once I had joined the group setting, and I wasn't doing privates anymore, which didn't last too long, when I did join the group setting, it was very like just welcoming and lovely and everything that I hoped it would be. Yeah.
So for those that are unaware though, because myself spoke to Brody this in a previous podcast, that you identify as non-binary. So that's something that I don't know if there's anyone else, especially in this country, that's wrestling that identifies that. Of course, there's many people that do. So that's obviously a difference maker. So like you said, we're not going to focus on this blokey culture thing. We will get away from it. But you're in that kind of weird position of the guys' sessions, the BO and sweat sessions are a bit too, like I say, blokey. They don't know, it could be lads, they might not accept you as a person, as who you are. I'm sure they would, but you know, in there's always that mentality there. Whereas like the all-female classes, it could be the same. So you're trying to find this kind of middle ground And yeah. Renegade seems to just have that culture. I'm sure that there will be other training schools that they'll have the exact same kind of mentality and culture, but Renegade at least is pushing in at the forefront of that exclusivity. Is their word they use, exclusivity, in there. So joining the group sessions, you said that actually we'll focus back on the non-binary bit because I've just kind of just ran all over that and then just carried on. So I don't know how much you want to talk about or how much knowledge I can use to ask you questions, but when did you first identify as a non-binary?
So it actually wasn't too long ago. It was about a year and a half ago, 2 years at Posh. I just moved into the flat that I'm in now, and I was kind of like, well, I've always felt like a queer person, like a person part of the LGBTQ community. But and before I'd identified as non-binary, I just identified as a gay male or a bisexual male. But just, yeah, having the space and freedom in this also very privileged environment I'm in at uni, which is very liberal and open, having space and freedom to just like feel out who I am and like situate myself within the broad range of gender and identities was, yeah, it was just something that I was coming to terms with. And then, I mean, even growing up, like I like to reference it back to that, watching the divas and the women, there was a reason that I was only obsessed with the women. And it wasn't necessarily because I was watching them in their bras and panties matches. It was because I identified with them and was like, I see myself in you and I want to be like you. So yeah, it was probably about a year and a half ago.
Like you say, that's really fresh then, especially when you're deciding to pursue this wrestling thing, and all that going through your mind before you even get your first session with Aisha. So that's, yeah, that's quite a fresh thing that you've just jumped into two footed and just went, ah, you know what, this is how I feel, this is how comfortable I am. Now that I've identified this way, I'm just going to go beat up some people instead in a controlled environment. Why not? Let's just do it. So you joined the group sessions, and you said, as you said, it's a very comfortable environment. Everyone was there for each other. How did you find working with? You already be tossed around by Aisha quite frequently at that point. But what was it like getting into that group environment with the likes of that would be the Struthers and Catspell and Brody, who I've already mentioned? What was that like?
I mean, at first, you know, they're all quite, especially the Struthers, they're quite intimidating. But without giving too much away, they are just lovely, lovely people at heart. And I mean, I'm obviously not going to out anyone that isn't necessarily comfortable to be openly public about it yet. But there are other members in the roster of the LGBTQ community. So to hear that reciprocated back to me is like, oh, I'm not the only one here too. And obviously, like you said, Renegade exclusively saying that they are an inclusive environment and promote that is just like a great place to be in. Because I also wondered, like, obviously intergender wrestling happens all the time all over the world, but with things like changing rooms, for example, backstage, I was always nervous that like I'd be grouped with the lads, or like I'd be grouped with just the girls, or it wouldn't be like I wouldn't be acknowledged for who I am. But I also went into that knowing full well that I might just have to deal with that like that's something that I'm comfortable with navigating if it came to it, for the sake of my passion for wrestling and wanting to do it. But that was also met with like just such open arms, you know. And they were like, well, we can put you where you're comfortable, and we can ask where if other people are comfortable with that, and we'll figure it out. And then we did. So it was really nice to hear that. But yes, the likes of Kat Speller, Brody Adler, the Struthers Sisters, Iona Sky, Jade Black. They are all wonderful people, and I'm loving to getting to know them more and more every time that we train. And obviously there's not always chance to chat loads, but I do get to chat a bit with them, and I'm becoming good friends with all of them. They are all lovely people. I haven't got honestly a negative thing to say about any of them.
I mean, we're still at time. You might find one or two. But no. We're a positive podcast here. We tried to be anyway. Unless I end up getting my soapbox about something or something else. But no, I like that. You don't want to be pigeonholed, but you're happy to compromise if it's for the greater good, so to speak. Yeah. If it means you get to go forward and you have to maybe just do one thing or another safely and consensually, then you're quite happy just to go that way, which I suppose same with anyone really, isn't it? If it's just the way the world works, a little bit of compromise goes a long way. So as I was hearing again, I'm referencing this chat with Brody because pretty much most of my information, because otherwise I've just got your three matches and that's about it. Otherwise of my information and my notes here. You're very quick from joining the group classes to being on the debut show for Renegade. So where did you find out that Aisha was kind of putting this together and that she was possibly putting you in a spot to compete not only once, but also a second time on that show?
I mean, not long after I joined the group classes, she was starting to like do matchups, and it almost felt as if I didn't even know I was going to be in it. And then she was like, of course you're in it. Like, you're great. You can wrestle and you're a great performer. Obviously you're in it. And I was like, oh my God, but like, this is what I came in to do. And like, I'm very excited for it. I mean,
the results now while you're doing that. So just so, cause I think you were the opening match, weren't you? For the show.
Yes.
So you've come into, you've been told you get a match. We'll go into the second match in a second as well. But first match in, you're against Tom Fulton. So you're not only going in with someone you possibly only spent very little time with, because Tom would have maybe came over for a session or two or even that. And you're putting the first match on this first show for Renegade Wrestling against, as I said, Tom Fulton. How do you react to be told that right, you're opening the show and you're going in with one of the most experienced wrestlers in the country?
Well, firstly, I was very intimidated, but I was also excited. Upon meeting Tom, he was very friendly and lovely, and I didn't know too much about his work because like I said, I'm only quite clued up on WWE and like pop culture wrestling, and I'm not too educated on like in the British wrestling scene. So it was intimidating, but also I knew working with a veteran like Tom that I would be safe, and he made me feel safe in it.
So when you're putting together London Lovelust, then the demeanor, the alter ego, what have you, of London, was there an image in mind that you had? What you presented on that first match, was that what you wanted to present, or is it just still a little bit of a work in progress?
That's a good question. I'm glad you asked that. The first match, I was a bit disappointed within, especially the personality of London, and I think it was just because it was my first match, and Tom is such like a character as well. I was like, whoa, like I don't know how to fit myself within this like highly performative world, you know. And it's not just the character that you've got to be, you've also got to wrestle. So navigating the intersection between those things was very like, I think I was too focused in the first match on the wrestling, but now I'm becoming more confident and comfortable with it, I have time to be in character, be London, and wrestle well, hopefully most of the time.
Let's have a wee look at what I said about the match, because I watched it, and obviously I'm on the other side of the barrier, so I have no experience. I've never taken a bump, never planned to do it either. But yeah, I did point out that there was definitely character work there, and there was definitely I put that the character part was down, but it was just putting it into the actual work, the in-ring work, and that's pretty much echoed what you said there. Is that you're focused on one thing, it didn't get translated into the other. And so there's definitely, yeah, I mean, like I say, it's your first match, opening the show, especially with all the ska and that went around Renegade starting, because, of course, it was supposed to be a different show, it's supposed to be run by a different company, promotion, and then all this kind of went in the same week, and then it still happened, and then you're going out there with Tom, and I suppose it is probably good that you didn't know of his reputation, because I think that would probably make you more nervous. I think that he's been wrestling since I've watched. So I've watched for over 10 years now. So yeah, he's been wrestling for a fair while, and he's got this massive character as well. And like I say, you coming in with London Lovelust, another potentially big character as well. It's just, yeah, it was picking your spots. And like I say, for a first match, I was happy with it. I've watched it enough to know what I like and know what I don't like, I suppose, at the end of the day. And you know, if my opinion counts for anything, then there you go.
Can I comment on that quickly?
Yes.
It totally did. I remember reading your, what would you call it? The, like, review.
I think review is, I suppose, what it's called. Words of that I write down. I review is probably pushing it, but carry on.
I remember reading the review and being like, you're so right. I do need to become the London Lovelust. And those were your words. And I was like, I know what I need to do. And then from that moment on, like in training sessions, I wasn't just Brandon anymore. I regularly method acted as London still do to like heighten it and get used to it. And because I don't want London to be a quiet character. I want them to be this larger than life character. So yeah, it was really nice to read your review and be like, you know what I need to do, and so do I.
it's weird because I've seen quite a few first matches or first couple matches in my years of watching wrestling in Scotland anyway. And it's always the same. It's literally the same where someone debuts and they're not entirely there with what they want to do. They're quite hunched over and they're small. And it's the weirdest thing to watch. And it's great to see it grow as well, because it's amazing to do that. But yeah, when you see someone finally just click and their arms, I said spread them wings is what I said in the review, because once you see them stop punching and they're like doing all the expressive movements and that, when you find out, I think when the more you find out about wrestling and more you get comfortable with your character, the less wrestling you have to actually do.
True. So true, which is not necessarily what I want to do though, because like, yeah. I love the performativity, but I love the moves in the wrestling more than anything, but you are so right. What makes a good performance is the performativity.
Yeah. I mean, the biggest wrestler in Scotland is Grado, and I'm fairly certain he's not taken a bump in at least 3 years. So from that, when you enjoy the moves and you like the art form of wrestling itself, was there anyone that you were particularly told to go check, go study? Was there, I'm thinking for a flamboyant character like London Lovelust, you might be put towards like Dalton Castle or even back in early 2000s, Rico or something like that. Someone that was like incorporated that flamboyance into their actual wrestling moves. Was there anyone in particular?
Totally. My only point of reference, which is strange because I am a queer wrestler, was Dolph Ziggler, which isn't a great reference, but I enjoyed his natural femininity and like, not even flamboyancy, but not arrogance either, but like something there. But yeah, Dalton Castle was a great reference point. And when I looked into him, I was like, wow, this is a different version of London Lovelust. I also got told about Sonny Kiss, who,
okay. Yeah.
Yeah. And his moves are also incredible. Not necessarily a huge fan of his style, but of his like wrestling style, but also obviously appreciate a queer wrestler in a bigger company. It's great to see. I'm not quite sure. Yeah.
But Dolph Ziggler's a great shout. I hadn't even thought about that, because yeah, he does rely a lot on his body language because I noted your crumple physics, which I love, because that's just I loved Lita growing up. I mean, I still do. I'm a 31 year old man. I still love Lita. But you know, she had this crumple physics thing, which made everything look more impactful. And Ziggler has the same, he overdoes it sometimes, but you know, it's still effective. It still makes the big moves be important. And I don't think there's few better that you could take reference points from as a result. Dolph Ziggler, who, I mean, folk may say that I'm wrong in saying, but he is kind of the kind of come down from, you had like Shawn Michaels and
Shawn Michaels is a great seller.
Yeah, Shawn Michaels, and you had maybe even a bit of Jeff Hardy in there as well with how he used his body to tell a story. And then you have Ziggler, who's been doing it for, 2006, I think he's doing it since, in WWE anyway. So he's certainly been able to tell a story with his body for so long that he's still active and still putting on great matches as well. So you had that one. You had that match, and that was your kind of confidence, your icebreaker when it came to wrestling. And then not even, was it 2 matches later, you were back out again. So Casabella was taking on the Struthers sisters, Maven and Raven Struthers, and she needed a tag team partner, and out you came. So again, you were put forward for this, or was there a space and you went, I'll do it? How did you end up in the second match on the same night?
Well, that's a good question. How did I end up in that match? I must have agreed to it. I mean, Katsavala needed someone of some stature to take on those two, right? Because they are scary. that was kind of just the plan for a little while that we didn't tell people. Like, Katsavala and I have a similar-ish aesthetic, same colours. Our characters go quite hand in hand, as I'm this like monarch and she's my kitty cat, you know, sort of thing. There you go.
Right, so it's looking like I'm just using a Dalton Castle reference, but you're kind of like a peacock, like scroll your colours and all that, and then like say Katsabella comes in. I remember really enjoying this match as well, because it was just, that was madness. It was just everyone everywhere. And the fact that you're still doing another match, so second match in on your first show is still just madness in itself. Because if the first match went, I mean, you say you weren't happy with it, but if the first match went absolutely disastrous, and then you're expected to come out again, and that would have been probably the worst thing for your confidence ever. But the crowd loved you. I remember that the crowd were very much just happy to see London Lovelust. I think there was I don't know if it was a group of your friends there, but there was definitely a good cluster of people doing absolutely nuts for you.
Yeah. They come every time. There was a few less of them at the last show a few days ago, but I have grown in fans now, and so it'll always be there.
So you had that first 2 matches in the bag, in the pocket, out of sight. And what were your kind of, how'd you come away from that show? Was it just like, right, I know what I'm going to do, I know what I need to do next kind of thing? Or was there anyone took you aside particularly that gave you a little bit of an extra puzzle to this puzzle of a wrestling character that you're going for?
To contextualize it a bit, I think one of the reasons that I was a bit like in my head, so to speak, in the first match with Tom is because I take naturally to being quite heelish. So knowing full well that Tom is a heel, I have to try and work a face angle. So now I'm much more comfortable with that face angle, or at least as a tweener, as I say. But go on.
No, I was gonna say, yeah, if you get the crowd on your side, you can do anything. As you could be overly confident, but as long as you've got the charisma to back up, it doesn't matter what side you're on, I suppose. But yeah, I suppose when I'm thinking about the match back again, yeah, the whole character of London Lovelust does scream just bad person, bad guy. But I mean, you're still able to kind of pull it into the middle land of, you can do bad stuff, but as long as, like I say, if you've got the charisma to pull it off, then it really doesn't matter. And you've got Kat Sabella, who's like adorable next year. Exactly. So how can you be booed when you've got her next year? And then you've got Jade Black as well. So there's a nice little contingent that you've got going on. I mean, could easily give it a couple of shows down the line, it could easily turn into be something a bit more sinister. But right as of right now, what I'm hearing and what I'm seeing is you're able to kind of, as I said, ride that line of just good enough to be cheered, but you know, there's an edge there somewhere.
There is.
For London Lovelust. I think that's what I was thinking at a preview. I even suggested it. I was even suggesting that maybe it needs to be a darker side of Lovelust. And I saw the results. I was like, no, they're not going that direction at all. So that's oh well. My track record with predictions are horrific. Anyway.
Well, I mean, if you watch the match with Iona and I back, I think she starts as the fan favorite. But then I end as a fan favorite. So, well, anyways, I was being quite pedantic, and you know, my manager Catalina doing my giving me my water and dabbing my sweat. So, yeah, I wasn't really wrestling. So I think if anything, I was a bit heelish at the beginning, and she was a bit more face-ish, but she got a bit pissed off with that. So.
Wrestling is so weird and subjective anyway, so like I won't repeat myself too much, but yeah, like, so as long as you can pull it off, then there's nothing that you can't do in wrestling, which is weird. It's because it's panto of the highest art form, in my opinion, when it comes to that. So we came into the second show then at Rebel, and we're well into the whole Struthers sisters running up to War Games. I'm just getting the results again in front of me. So yeah, as you said, you were against Diana on a Sky, and she ended up siding with the Struthers sisters. Even though you said that they're outside of wrestling events, they're nice people. And even though, I mean, I interviewed them for the start of the season of the show, and they were very nice, but there was always a little bit of fear at my end anyway. So you had that, you brought Kat Sabella and Jade Black as well, and formed the House of Lovelust.
Nice.
So what was the kind of idea behind House of Lovelust? So you already had that kind of connection with Kat Sabella from the first show. How did you bring in Jade Black?
So Jade Black is a fairly new trainee, and from the moment that she walked in, we were pretty like friendly with each other, and We're a similar age, so we've grown up with similar references to WWE and stuff. And she also has a natural background in gymnastics. So, yeah, she's also just another baby face that can make the crowd love me. No, I don't use her. I don't.
I'm liking this. I'm looking forward to seeing how this evolves. But yeah, so that's great then. So you got someone who, like I say, similar age. So if Aisha makes a reference about something from early 2000s and you're confused, at least Jade's going to be there confused with you.
Well, actually, you know what? Jade is much more educated on it than I am. But I'll give it that.
Well, speaking of that, you said you've got the pennies together, and you've got the WWE Network. How far have you went back? Are you still just kind of reliving the pay-per-views and shows that you remember when you were growing up?
Mm-hmm. Every now and then I get to watch one that I haven't seen that's a bit older. What was the last one that I watched? I think the last one I watched was Lita's Farewell Match.
Oh, God. I from 2006.
I think it's 2006. And I was bloody shocked at the way they treated it. Well, I mean, obviously things were so different back then, but I don't know who those two guys were bringing out her panties and shit, but like, damn.
Like, oh, the wonderful time of Crime Time.
Is that who they are? I
don't, yeah. Yep, JTG and Shad Gaspard. That was a very interesting time in wrestling. I think it was 2006, maybe 2007 actually. But either way, yeah, it's when you go back and I suppose, yeah, when you started watching 2009, 2010-ish kind of thing, yeah, it was still Divas, but there was a bit more wrestling involved. Whereas, yeah 2006 with Lita and her box of stuff. that was thrown into the crowd. At least she got redemption. At least she got a redemption with Becky Lynch and the Rumble appearances previously. There was a bit of that back. But so, one odd one to pop in was just, did you just want to see a Lita match? Was it, how did you end up on that one in particular?
I think me and my manager. So I live with my flatmate / manager Catalina. When we have the time, we'll just, like, one of us will say a wrestler's name and one of us will say a year, if they're around that year, obviously. Mm-hmm. And then we'll just see what comes up.
Right. I'm going to see what was the rest of this card, because I'm just curious.
I mean, we'll often look, it's really just the women that we watch, and we'll often look up older years and there's never anything. Actually, Jade Black told me to watch 1989 Team May versus Team Moolah or something.
Oh, that's before my time. But if it's something with Jumping Bomb Angels, you're probably into a good ska stuff, because yeah, there's pretty good stuff around about then. And I've forgotten the event which it was. So we'll just leave it there. I thought it was a No Mercy.
I think it's Survivor Series, but I might be wrong.
Let's see. We'll find it. We're a professional podcast here, where I'm just going to take my time and find this. Survivor Series. This is great for everyone that's listened to the audio version of me typing, because I'm just so curious what it was now. Let's see.
I've also never watched the match where Lita almost broke her neck. I really want to watch that one.
It's a Raw match. I think the main event, and she like broke it. Well, I don't think she broke her neck in that match. She broke it on Dark Angel, doing stunt work, I think. But yeah, there was a disgusting bump that was just horrific to watch. I mean, there was a documentary, Unforgiven, that's what it was. Unforgiven. There was a documentary on WWE Network recently. It might be an actual interview with Stone Cold Steve Austin that really kind of went through it and discussed it. So yeah, Trish Stratus to be Aaliyah by submission. Well, that's what we got here. So we got Joy Nitro against Jeff Hardy. Always good. Bit of Melina. Nice.
Oh, was it?
Kane versus Umaga. I bet that was terrible. We got the Spirit Squad. There you go. There's a bit of Dolph Ziggler. He wasn't in the match, though. He was ringside against the Highlanders. For anyone who wants to revisit that, I love the Highlanders because they had kilts. Cooler than that. DX versus Big Show, Mr. McMahon and Shane McMahon, Hell in a Cell. Stratus versus Lita. Randy Orton versus Carlito. And John Cena versus Edge. So if anyone wants to go revisit Unforgiven 2006, there you go.
There's so many names there that are just so like... Oh, you know?
I know people didn't like this era. It was just a bit weird. And then when I go back through the shows, I'm like, how can you not like this? This is just entertainment of a highest order, in my opinion, anyway. Because I'm not one of those people that had the break. I never stopped. I was always, so from 1999 to now, I've just never stopped watching. And when people go, I took a break then and came back at this point, I'm like, oof, there's a lot happened in that break in the middle there for you. It's ones that come in like quite late on 2010, like yourself. I'm like, well, people didn't like this, but I suppose if you came into it at that time, then
you will.
Yeah, exactly. Well, you're not gonna be cooing over the Attitude Era because you never watched it. So how are you gonna coo about something you never seen? I wouldn't go back to the Attitude Era if you're looking for women's stuff anyway. It's
no. I don't imagine.
No, it's yeah. If you thought Lita's box being thrown about was this in bad taste, actually, it was not for you. It was it was a time. So at that then, we got your two matches in. We're building towards this. You've had your match with Iowa Sky. This is building to War Games, a power of three. Got new bit of confidence. You've got Catalina, you've got the House of Lovelust. Everything's kind of coming up London, so to speak, as you come into the show. So, of course, it was a 3-on-3. You ended up winning. But, of course, it was bits afterwards that maybe you didn't come out looking like a winner.
Yeah.
But how would you feel about that 3-on-3 match? So again, this is you've been put into the deep end, really, when it comes to Renegade. So you had your first two matches in your first show. You're put in with Iona, who's got a bit more experience in training, but even then, it's only her second match. And then you're put into this 3-on-3 environment, which is a big main event, again, main event of the show as well. So how have you felt about the match, and how do you feel about being thrust into these kind of big situations, big opportunities in Renegade?
I mean, yeah, it was, I would remember saying backstage, like, oh shit, we're the main event, like, we're the last one, we need to, like, leave the crowd, you know, going home happy, which the Struthers did not do. But, I mean, in ways, I want to say, as arrogant as this might sound, I want to say, like, the stage is my place to shine, and I take to these big opportunities well, usually. So it was mainly excitement, and like I'm very proud of what I've done, and I'm very proud of the House of Love Lost, and the Struthers, we'll see if they're back.
So I mean, that's pretty much us up to date when it comes to your actual in-ring work itself. I'll go through we've got loads of questions on Facebook. God, how old am I? Twitter. It's Twitter that's just on. I don't know whether it's because I'm getting older or if I'm going to be a dad soon. I'm just like growing up and getting all the dad stuff in, but I call everything the Facebook at the moment, and I don't even mean to, and it annoys me when my own folks do it, and it's just happening. It's evolving. So we've got loads of questions in, and we've got our two silly questions. I don't know if anyone at Renegades has given you the heads up of this ridiculous questions we ask everyone. Yeah. But we'll go through the ones that people have asked first. We've got Leo McLean.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, he did an episode with us a week or so ago, for those that are in the continuity timeline. It just asked, how do you prepare for a match with the Struthers sisters?
That's a good question. I usually prepare for a match with them by doing lots and lots of squats, because they won't I'm saying this here and now, so maybe it's not the wisest thing to do, but to answer Leo's question, I don't think they expect me to be able to overpower them. So then when I crack that out, it's like, oh shit. You know, I prepare by doing that. I don't often get a manicure done because they'll just ruin it. Which they like to do, which they did on the first show. Very rude. But yeah, what else did I do? Obviously, teamwork amongst the House of Lovelust, because it was a team match, and perhaps I re-study and re-watch sort of their sort of offense, you know, and maybe keep a close eye on them in training, sort of thing.
Good. We've got Chris Farrell of Chris Farrell Photography for all your photography needs. He's put, what's your favorite photo that he's taken of you?
Oh, that's another good question. My favorite photo that he's taken of me is, let me show you, it's the one that's pinned to the top of my timeline on Twitter. It's this one, because I just think I don't know if you can see that.
I can see it. I'm just getting up on the Twitter as well. On the Twitter. I'm just doing it unconsciously. That's annoying me so much. Yes, I can see it now. Yes, very, very radiant and And I said peacocking. That's pretty much, that's what we've got there. That's what we've got going on.
Peacocky. Peacocks are one of my favorite animals. So I never, maybe I subconsciously like thought about that when I was designing what I wanted to wear or figuring out what I wanted to wear. But no, yes, Chris, this is my favorite photo because it's just this glorious snapshot of my gorgeousness. Yes.
And we've got Regina Rosendahl as well. She's asked, why are you so obsessed with her?
Oh, girl, why am I obsessed with you? I could talk all day about Regina. She is an incredible woman. Why am I obsessed with her? I think I'm obsessed with her because she's just like this powerful, beautiful human that is like colorful and has some great offense. So I'm just like, wow, I look up to you. Like, I want to be like you. If I ever got the opportunity to tag team with her or even be in a match against her, that would be a dream come true. She's a remarkable woman.
Another one that I've been lucky enough to have a chat with. And yeah, she's just unapologetic. She's what you see is what you get with Regina. Oh. And she's just like, well, if you want to see me batter someone, that's what's going to happen, right? You know? And so it's yeah, just she's excellent and
confident,
absolutely.
All I
The last question is a bit of a weird one in this particular section. It's from Ian Skinner. I don't know if you've had the pleasure of meeting Ian Skinner before. He's a character. He's just put, what do you like about this picture of General Grievous? And just put a picture of General Grievous up with the four lightsabers.
Well, I presume this is because it's the May the 4th be with you day.
That is probably it. Although it was probably 23 hours ago, so he was jumping on the gun by putting out on the 3rd, May the 3rd. That's not a thing. So yeah, any thoughts on Star Wars in general as a youngin?
Never seen it. Don't hate me.
That's fine. I've only ever seen. I saw the originals. I wasn't alive for them. I saw them later, and I've seen the original the redone trilogy, episode 1 to 3, and then I watched Force Awakens, and that's about all I've gotten. So I'm terrible for May the 4th because I have no idea. I think I know where that particular picture is from the episode, the film, but I'm too scared to say which because I'm probably wrong. Because you know. Star Wars fans, much like wrestling fans, are quite opinionated, and they're quite terrifying when they need to be. So we got that. That was the last question that came in today. Absolutely weird. Thank you, Ian, for just never changing. But no, there's some excellent questions. The questions that we ask, though, they're just as stupid. The first question being, what's your favorite dinosaur?
My favorite dinosaur? Oh my God. Ooh. I'm not too educated on dinosaurs, but
there's no limits. So it could be something from pop culture. It could be a Pokemon. It could be anything. As long as
it's kind of Pokemon.
As long as it could be a dinosaur. That's pretty much the only remake here.
So it can be a Pokemon or not?
No, it can be as long as it's a dinosaur. So like apparently you got Trinitar and you got. I've said Charizard, but apparently I'm wrong.
He's a dragon.
No, dragon type, though. We've got Charmander. Charmander's still a dinosaur, I think, I would say. So, you know, there's still, like, people can answer Barney. That could be a dinosaur. Someone answered Harmony Sky said turkey dinosaurs. So there's loopholes if you don't want to answer an actual dinosaur that may or may not have existed.
From dinosaurs that I do know, I quite like pterodactyls because they can fly. But I also is it the Diplodocus that is like the tall one, the really tall one?
Because there's a few of them. I didn't really used to start learning my dinosaurs. Diplodocus. That's the long one with the big long neck. Yeah,
I like Diplodocus too. Diplodoci, perhaps.
Okay, I confuse them with the Brachiosaurus because it's kind of quite similar in long neckage when it comes to dinosaurs. But No, no, that's fine. They're all solid choices of dinosaurs. It's weird. I've only got maybe an hour 20 times I'm going to ask this question, and then it's gone forever. Nobody gets to know what other people's dinosaurs are, their favorite dinosaurs from that point. The other question we ask is, what would win a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Could you say that again? Repeat that, please.
What would win a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Two sheep or one cow? Ooh. I actually feel... Are we talking just generic two sheep and one cow?
Again, this is up to your imagination. It could be a Highland cow. It could be two. It could be a calf against two lambs. It could be anything.
You know what? I'm going to say the cow, because sheep are quite timid, and I've tried to chase sheep before, and they don't really, accept me into their herd. I'm gonna go cow.
Fair enough. That's absolutely fine. There's no wrong answer there.
Brilliant. Who won?
there's no wrong answer. However, again, back to Leo McLean, because I'm still fascinated by this. He sent me to a video on YouTube of a sheep against a cow, and it was only 15 seconds, but it answered all the questions I needed in my life. So, again, this is probably the fourth episode in a row I've done this now. Go Google sheep versus cow on YouTube, people, because it's fascinating. And it just means I am right as well. So we've covered all that and the shenanigans of our questions as well. And we'll move on to looking at the future of London Lovelust. Of course, you've had a few matches in Renegade Wrestling Dojo now. Is this quite happy where you are at the moment? Or is any possible inklings or plans to maybe to spread your wings elsewhere?
Well, Aisha is away for a year, sadly, as she announced at the last show in Japan, becoming the legend she already is. So I'm quite happy. Well, I'm very happy as Renegade as my home base, but I have had a couple of promoters here and there say they're interested in having me on their shows. I won't mention exactly where, just in case, it doesn't follow through. But I had someone in Finland interested. I had someone it's bad of me, it's either Austria or Germany interested. And one other Scottish promotion so far. So I'm not opposed to branching out. London Lovelust is very keen to travel and see the world. So please book me.
That's fine. So I want to ask you what promotions you want to try and get to, because I think that might cause some spoilers. But I assume your big companies like your I mean, again, ones you may not have seen but have heard of, things like Discovery and ICW and EVE and all that kind of stuff will be places you want to at least tick off on your journey for London Lovelust. Is there any particular opponents? We've already mentioned Regina Rosendahl being someone you want to get in the ring with. Is there anyone on your shortlist that you want to get in the ring and have a wrestle with in the near future?
In the near future, so it has to be, like, doable.
We'll start. We do have a question that'll follow up that'll be later, but we'll go with near future. So yeah, doable.
Mm-hmm. I would love to wrestle Aisha Raymond. I mean, we get on very well as people, but I would just love to see how long I can outlast against her before she defeats me. also, not many people can pick me up and throw me around because I'm deceptively heavy and 6 feet. So. Leo McLean, I'd also love to wrestle with because he is a whippet in the ring with some great offense. Who else? Again, I'd love to go against my partner, Jade Black, because we're of similar moves and similar, our bodies move in similar ways, so... she's part of my team
for now. So I mean, I don't know what they're feeding the folks that come out of well, because Renegade takes place at Source Wrestling School as well. But there's all these 6 feet folk that are coming out of that school, coming out of there. It's just ridiculous. It's yourself, and you got like Colton Davis and Cody Crawford as well, is a bit over 6 foot. ADM, of course. So it's I don't know what's happening down there, and they're just breeding giants coming out of there. So yeah, we'll expand the question like so after that, because the last question's a fantasy booking one. So Vince McMahon's phoned, or will be Vince McMahon, because you're a WWE person, so that's fine. That makes it easier for me. Vince McMahon's phoned. He said he's giving you the main event at WrestleMania. He said that you get to choose the match, the stipulation, your opponent or opponents. So it could be a tag team match, it could be a six person Hell in a Cell, it could be anything you want. You get to choose it. What would it be? You're in it, of course. You're in the match, I should say. Yeah. So yeah, you get to pick. You get to organize it all. What would it be?
I could do anything. Oh, my! I'm just gonna go with my instinct and not overthink it too much. My instinct would say, like, the groundbreaking first ever intergender Royal Rumble. And I know there have been women and men competing each, but it's usually just one, like Santina Marilla or like Nia Jax. Yeah. So, yeah, my instinct would be an intergender Royal Rumble. And then I would love to see the likes of Mickey James, is one of my top tier wrestlers of all time. The way she sells her moves. Rhea Ripley, obsessed with her and her gimmick. Absolutely obsessed. Love her. Charlotte Flair, I do love her. Just her like sadistic, fucking nasty side. I love. And she's a bitch. Which I kind of want to be. Who else?
I'm already sold, by the way, because Royal Rumble is my favorite event of the year. And to have, have it in the main event at WrestleMania and be it intergender, I'm like, yes. Give me Charlotte beating up. I know, an Uso. Just give me something like that. I'm all in board. I'm on board for this already.
Oh, yeah. Right? It sounds incredible. We should make it up as well.
I'll get Vince on the phone. I'll DM him and I'll get it suggested. But no, yeah, that's I like that you've like not many people take advantage of this, because when I say anything, literally anything, and you're the first person to bring up a rumble of any description, I'm like, really? How else? If you come in number one and you're in charge of this, you're gonna get to the end at very least. So you can pick 29 people that you just want to be in the ring with.
Yeah. Rumble each one of them.
Yeah, exactly. Number one, you're in first. Number two, Charlotte Flair. And number three, Bolton Castle. You can bring him in. So you can. It's to your mind's content. Yeah, absolute excellent plan. I'm happy with that. Right. So I think we've kind of delved into the House of Lovelust a little bit. We've got to learn a little bit more about you. Where can people find out more about the monarch of the House of Lovelust?
Oh. The only place as of now that you can find out more about London Lovelust and the House of Lovelust is my Twitter handle, which is simply just London Lovelust. Yes.
Easy to remember. That's fine. Well, great. So thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me today. Is there anything else you want to plug before we go? Have you got any merch coming out soon, or you just have to wait patiently for that?
Well, the creative juices are flowing in my mind and I'm training vigorously. So just wait.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.